Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for the gospel. Thank you for your word. Thank you for your Holy Spirit that speaks to us through this word and brings life to dead sinners. Thank you for its incredible power. And we thank you for those that you have called to preach, to go and stand in the temple courts, to stand in the marketplace, and to proclaim that Jesus Christ is risen. We thank you for Dr. Chapel. We pray that your Holy Spirit will just bless and empower him and open our minds and thoughts and hearts to what we can learn about the gospel, about your word, and about this incredible task of preaching. We commit this morning to you in Jesus' name. Amen. Dr. Chapel, welcome.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Vim. It's good to be with you again in a very different place from when I think I was here in 2010. So the Lord has blessed, and I'm thankful for that for your sake. And to be with the Lutheran brethren as we approach the 500th anniversary of the Reformation, maybe a special time to be thinking about our past together and what it may be instructing us in. If you think about not just the Wittenberg door, but events that led up to that, one of the very important cultural moments pre-Reformation was Michelangelo Caravaggio's painting of the Supper at Emmaus in 1601. And we often talk about the road to Emmaus. Remember that. Luke 24, Jesus is walking on the road after the resurrection, and for reasons we don't quite understand, disciples do not recognize who he is. But we read, beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he revealed what was said in all the scriptures, the things concerning what? Himself. Beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he revealed the things concerning himself. Now, again, at that point, the disciples don't get it. You know, they don't understand who he is and what has happened. But they go on to the supper at Emmaus. And in the supper at Emmaus, there comes a moment at which they recognize him. What's the moment at which they say, this is that Jesus? What's the moment at which they recognize it's Jesus? In the breaking of the bread. And it is that moment that Caravaggio captures. As Jesus is pictured breaking the bread, what is revolutionary in the painting of Caravaggio is first just how Jesus and the disciples are pictured. Okay, first, they have no beards. They just look like ordinary working people of the time. They are not dignified the way the aristocracy would be. They have no halos, you know, not the conventions of the era. Nor do they, as disciples, when they recognize Jesus, just kind of sit back in glassy-eyed wonder, oh, isn't it amazing that Jesus is here? No, what Caravaggio captures is, what would it mean if this Jesus is now before us as the fulfillment of the ages? That what he had said on the road, as our hearts burned within us, that beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he revealed what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself. And now he is here, the risen Lord. He is with us now. The promises are fulfilled, and he is here. What Caravaggio captures is not the disciples sitting in glassy-eyed wonder, but rather they are rising from their seats. Their muscles are taut. In the painting that's depicted, even one of them is inviting the viewer into the scene, as in, join the mission now, because if Christ is in fact come the fulfillment of the ages, there is something to do about it. And what they are depicted as representing in the painting of Caravaggio is the calling of God's people to mission in the light of who Christ is and what he has done. It's not just something to receive. There is something to be done about the reality of the coming of Christ as the fulfillment of the ages. I say that to you today because my theme, with Dr. Vim's approval, is how does our understanding of the grace of God unfolding in all the Scripture affect our preaching of application, what we actually do about the Scriptures? Because oftentimes we think that these are separate conversations, that this unfolding of the history of grace, the biblical theology, is something we're supposed to know for proper biblical interpretation. But we don't often see how, if that is in fact the case, the Bible has unfolded to the moment of the revelation of Christ, that there are now things to be done as a consequence, then that biblical theology has a direct application to our process of preaching as we instruct God's people. So just to put it in visual terms, if we kind of take the Bible story and put it in familiar terms, we begin with creation. We know ultimately there is a consummation, but important things are happening between there. Between the creation and the consummation, there was a fall. And if we just put it in the simplest terms, we recognize that everything was made good. Everything went bad. And ultimately, everything is made perfect, which, by the way, is even better than good. But the biblical record is primarily of this time. And so you have to say, what is happening between the fall and the consummation? And lots of you know, we phrase it in different terms, in different theological circles, but creation, fall, redemption, consummation. That we are in this period of redemption. And what Jesus did when, after his crucifixion, at the resurrection, beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he revealed what was said in all the scriptures, the things concerning himself, is he is now calling us to recognize not only who he is, but the response of the people of God that is being called for. Are our muscles taut? Are we calling God's people to action in light of what Christ has done and who he now calls us to be as his people? What I'm leading us to think about, of course, is the whole subject of the application of the message of the gospel in our preaching. If you just kind of take in general terms, what is application? I'll use the general terms of homiletics for a while, and then we'll go deeper. If you say, what is application? In its simplest terms, application is the personal consequence of biblical truth. It is the personal consequence of biblical truth. We often think that what we're doing is preaching is I'm explaining the meaning of a text. All true, all important. But if you work hermeneutically as well as homiletically, meaning is not really understood if you don't know the significance of the text. I know what it means. Well, what's its significance to you? Well, I don't know. Well, then probably you don't really know what it means. That the significance of the text is integral to having personal understanding it. So what's the personal consequence? And lots of the great debates in homiletics in the history of preaching is, how significant is significance for meaning? Can I explain meaning without telling you the significance? Is that just the Holy Spirit's job, the Solus Spiritus school? You know, it's just the Holy Spirit. We don't tell people the significance. But in plain terms, if even the preacher doesn't know the significance, then it's probably fairly unlikely the people are going to figure out the significance. Application is saying, I'm not just telling you what the scriptures mean theologically, historically. I'm actually trying to tell you what is the significance with the understanding. If you don't know the significance, you probably don't know the meaning. At least not as a whole person, whole being understanding. Application in its essence is saying, what is the personal consequence of the truth that we expound so that you know its significance? If you know its significance, it may help us to talk about application. That means it's not just a matter of behavior. It's important for us, I think, to understand as preachers that application sometimes gets a bad reputation in the field of homiletics, because it's only being described in terms of behaviors, right? What can I tell you to do as a consequence of what the Scripture teaches? But if you take the words of Proverbs 4, above all things guard your heart, for out of it are the issues of life. That application, rightly perceived, is about attitude as well as about behavior. what's going on in your heart? I mean, almost all of us, when we first graduate from seminary, right, we are very focused in our preaching on behaviors, right? So the first sermon is, you should pray more. And the second sermon is, you should read your Bible more. And the third sermon is, you should go to church more, especially you should go to my church more. And the fourth sermon, we're not really sure about, because we already covered praying more and reading your Bible more and going, well, I mean, what else is there, you know? And so we begin to multiply behaviors. Well, you know, don't drink too much. Don't go to the wrong internet sites. You know, don't drink or smoke or chew or go with the girls that do. And so we multiply behaviors, and we're really not sure what else application is. I mean, even what I'm supposed to do to tell people to be good. But if you listen to preachers not in their first 5 years of preaching, if you listen to the people that you respect and you long to hear who are 25 or 30 years into their preaching, and you actually begin to kind of look at proportions, you'll begin to discover they're talking far more about attitudes than they are about behaviors. It's not that they think behaviors are unimportant, but somewhere in our preaching, we discover out of the heart are the issues of life. And if I get behavior change without heart transformation, I actually am not getting what the gospel is after. So that attitude, what's going on in your heart, is as important, more important, than the behaviors. And I say that because sometimes the whole discussion of application gets derailed by kind of, this just sounds like legalism, you're just talking about behaviors. Application, if it's really about the personal consequence of biblical truth, is about the heart, the attitude, as well as behaviors. It's not one or the other, but it recognizes that attitude is a legitimate subject as well as behaviors. If you think about why is that important in the field of preaching, you just have to look at some of the major exponents of what preaching is supposed to be and what they talk about in terms of application. David, you all teach expository preaching here. Yes? Try to. We usually think in North American circles, the father of expository preaching was a man named John Broadus. So just quick history, right? Higher critical understanding is coming into the United States. The Christian consensus of what the Bible teaches is breaking down. For most of 20 centuries, most of Christian preaching has been topical preaching, sometimes known as topical doctrinal preaching. And almost no matter where you look in the history of preaching prior to Broadus, you take a verse and you begin to explode its doctrinal implications by looking at similar verses and build the doctrine. It wasn't that it was devoid of exegetical study, but the whole notion of taking a text and beginning to divide it according to its own features and context was not the predominant preaching. Predominant preaching was topical doctrinal. But when the Christian consensus began to break down and you had German higher criticism coming to the United States and people began to talk about the virgin birth not being true and the atonement just being kind of one of the messages that could be about how Christians were saved, not necessarily what Christ himself would have taught us, you have people saying, well, wait, you know, they're still quoting the scriptures, but the scripture is not being quoted in its context. And as we know, the reason every heretic has his verse is he takes it out of context, right? And so what had become doctrinal topical preaching actually began to be used against the faith. And John Broadus, who was a professor preaching at Southern Seminary, began to look for a way of kind of locking down the meaning of the text when we preach. And so he began to teach something that was known as expositional preaching, which was trying to lock our preaching to the ancient methods of interpretation for the orthodox faith of the ancients. And so what he says was, expository preaching is preaching not just the subject of a text, but every text in its context is being preached according to its theme, its main points, and its developmental or subpoints. An expository sermon takes its theme, its main points, and its subpoints from the text, which locks you into saying what the biblical author intended to say, instead of what we can do if I say a little bit from here and a little bit from... I mean, if I just kind of pick and choose how I'm going to explain a text by going to all kinds of other places, I can kind of make the Bible say anything I want to. But if I will say this text in its context, theme, main points, subpoints, John Broadus says that will lock us down to the meaning of the text. Now, if you take John Broadus kind of as an example, there's the father of expository preaching as we practice it in North American circles. What would you think if you kind of take the major components of the average sermon, and if you say kind of what do we typically think of as the major components of a sermon? Explanation, illustration, application. What would you think the father of expository preaching says is the most important thing to do in preaching? Explanation, illustration, application. Which did Broadus say is the most important? Which do you expect him to say? You expect him to say explanation. What did he say? Application. He said application is the main thing to be done, because he believed that transformation is what preaching is primarily about. We debate these things in preaching circles. Is preaching primarily about addressing the intellect or primarily addressing the will? Are we primarily ministers of information or are we primarily ministers of transformation? What would you say? Primarily ministers of information or transformation? Transformation. Which means, of course, we have to give information. But we are saying there is a purpose for which we are driving. And it's somewhat changing our model of what we think we are doing when we preach. Because we are trained to do preaching typically in academic circles, we typically think the big stone that I'm trying to move in the process of preaching is I'm trying to move the explanation of the text into people's hearts and minds. And so my outline, my exegesis, my illustrations, my contextualization, you know, all these are things I'm loading up to try to move explanation into people's minds. Broadus actually was changing the model. He said, we are using all these things on the foundation of explanation, but it is to move application. That the primary thing I'm trying to do is have people understand the personal consequence of the biblical truth. To simply be filled up in the mind, the Apostle Paul told us, remember, knowledge, I love the King James here, knowledge puffeth up. if that's all that's happening, if you're just now gaining more knowledge, then you begin to recognize that all you're doing is you're saying you increase in your Christian performance simply because you've increased in your Christian competence. Well, you can be a very smart person and have a lot of biblical facts and still be very far from the Lord. We recognize that preaching is primarily a redemptive act. It is not primarily a lecture, right? If I'm just about getting information, that will organize the way I organize my information and even the amount of time I give to different components of the message. But I have to say the primary thing I'm about is giving you the information and motivation and examples sufficient for transformation. Now, that's a slightly different agenda that has a significant impact upon what we do. Not only do we take someone like John Broadus who says, you know, that application is the main thing to be done, we have only to look at some of our own times experience and say, have we gauged how important application is? If you look at our generational experience, you would recognize that those who survey us, Bible-believing, however you identify it, evangelical people in today's culture, some of you have even read the recent materials by Ed Stetzer. He would say, you know, since the 1940s, the number of people claiming to be born again in this culture has basically not changed. Now, for all the erosion of culture and morals and so forth, we'd say about a third of the United States population, it varies a little bit, goes down as about as low as 27% during the 1960s. It's actually higher now, around 30%. About a third of the nation claims to be born again. Hasn't changed since the late 1940s. But if you begin to survey those people who claim to be born again, you know, all these statistics that pastors throw out these days, our behaviors are not much different than the culture around us, right? The divorce rate is not much different. In fact, it's a little higher among those who claim to be born again. Now, you might say that's because those who claim to be born again are actually getting married, you know. But nonetheless, our divorce rate is actually a little higher. If you look at the rate of drunkenness, it actually increases after people claim to be born again. Drug use, pornography use, not much different than the surrounding culture. That can be very discouraging. And we can debate all the surveys. Some of them are really being pushed right now. Is the divorce rate really greater among born-again people? Some of you have read the Focus on the Family, pushed hard against that, you know, say that's not true. Our divorce rate is actually lower than the general pulpit, than the general public. But the Focus on the Family surveys only moved it down to say something on the order of 37% of evangelicals, born-again people, were getting divorced instead of 50%. Some of the recent studies by Stetzer are really amazing, because what he says is a lot of people who claim to be born again, so just straight talk with you here, a lot of people who claim to be born again are people who are culturally Christian in a demographic that is often uneducated, poor, and Southern. And often the reason they become born again is because they have desperate situations in their lives. And born again is kind of the last alternative of what, you know, my granddaddy believed that I hope will help me out. And so those who claim to be born again said roughly half of them are not even attending church. Roughly half of them are not even attending church. That being born again is kind of, you know, as I said, that last lifeline. That if you actually look at those who are regular church attending and you say, what's the marriage rate and divorce rate of those who are regularly church attending? This is going to be amazing. And those who pray together as couples daily. The marriage retention rate is over 90%. Now, this is an amazing thought. I mean, it's in a kind of an encouraging note. But it is saying people who are thinking through the personal consequence of Scripture have dramatically different lives and marriages and patterns and practices, and they have been helped by thinking about the personal consequence, and they're living out the personal consequence of their faith. That application is significant because we are looking for life transformation, and if you will, even life help. People are dramatically changed when they actually know how the Scriptures apply and they are living that way. And it affects not just how people live. It also affects what they hear from us. I'm going to do something that those of you who have read some of my work, this will be easy for you, but just to do it again. If you say application is not only important for what people hear from us, but what they consider to be our message when we preach. Any message that you preach, if you're trying to persuade people, this is true and this has implications for your life. Any persuasive message, by necessity, has three components: logos, pathos, ethos. Those of you who've had homiletics training want to help me with this. Logos is what component of your message? Logos means what? Word. It's the verbal content of the message, okay? So you say, in order to communicate anything to anybody, there is a logos, there's verbal content to the message, okay? That includes everything from the definitions of terms, understanding what you're saying, the organization, the outline. There's verbal content. If there's no verbal content or is not decipherable, then there's not a very persuasive message, right? So we have to have logos. What is pathos? If logos is verbal content, what is the pathos? I'm convincing you, I'm persuading you by the pathos of my message. What is pathos? Thank you. It is the emotive content. Which again, in Western culture, we don't think of, because we think of as emotions as not being central, because we think of them as being manipulative, right? I'm a Western male. You know, my great examples are Harrison Ford or John Wayne, depending on the generation, or Johnny Depp, depending on another generation, you know. So I'm the great unmoved hero, right? And so we don't want to manipulate people with emotions. But we forget that the manner with which I express something is my first witness to the truth of it. If manner contradicts content, the old preacher's rule, if manner contradicts message, which will be believed? If manner contradicts message, which will be believed? Manner.
Listen, this is really important. I think you ought to listen to this, because if you don't listen to this, you'll go to hell. It's really important.
It's really important. If you don't listen, you'll go to hell. But if I say it with a yawn, what have I just communicated? It's not important at all. My daughter says to me, Dad, do I really have to do my homework before I go out to the party? And I say, no. What did I really just say? I said, yes. Okay. If manner contradicts message, it is manner that will be believed. Manner is our first witness that the message that I am preaching has had an impact upon me. I witness to the authenticity of it. I witness to the truth of it. I witness to the impact of it, because in whatever way is authentic and real and appropriate for my personality, I'm saying what I really mean as though I really mean it. And the inability to say what I really mean as though I really mean it is actually to undercut its truth, to testify against it by my manner, and we don't even know that we are doing that. The last aspect of any message that's important is ethos. What is ethos? Not verbal content, not emotive content. What is the ethos that communicates the truth of a message? It is the perceived character of the speaker. Do you live and act in accord with what you are saying? Not just is your manner your witness, are you the witness of the truth of the word? Manner is communicated by authentic emotions. Ethos is almost always communicated by what I'm going to call the CNC. People are evaluating your character by credibility and compassion. Should I listen to you? Are you credible? Do you know what you're talking about? Does it make sense what you're saying? This is saying, I can see in the text something, and you're making sense when you talk about it, or the contrary, you don't make sense when you talk about it, right? Credibility is communicated by things like outlines, by clarity, by logic. Credibility that sometimes, you know, we don't want to have to deal with those things. Nonetheless, our credibility is being weighed by the way in which we are presenting the truth and the way in which we live before the people. The other aspect of ethos is compassion. Do you care about whom? Your listeners. Do they perceive you care about them? Now, all of us experience the dynamic of ethos at times when we go and visit relatives and they want us to go to church with them because they say, they've got this wonderful preacher. I just really want you to hear this great guy who preaches to us. We just want you to hear him and we love him. And so you go and you listen to that preacher's sermon and you go away saying, that was really bad. But they listen. Why do they listen? Why are they moved? Because he does what? Because he cares. And they know he cares. One of the ways that we show that we care is that we get organized. People, when they hear us disorganized, they don't just think that we aren't smart, that we're not credible. They actually think we don't care. When we use words they don't understand, when we fall back into academic models that are putting things way at this level instead of saying, I'm going to try to help you with what you're struggling with in life, when we don't come into their lives, when we've just done a whole lot of understanding of, you know, what fide is and justification by faith alone, and people are just saying, Pastor, do you recognize that my daughter didn't come home last night? Have you got any word for me? Do you care about what I'm going through? You got another theology lesson for me today? Great. Do you understand what's going on in my life? ultimately, application is saying there is a personal consequence to this truth. And it shows that I care about what you're going through. Because I can show lots of credibility, but if there is not compassion that goes with that, I can say how this makes a difference, how this helps, what it deals with in your life. If that never comes to the fore, then ethos is itself damaged. Now, why is that important? We say to persuade anybody, there has to be logos, pathos, and ethos. These are Aristotelian terms. Even a secularist says, which of these are the most important for persuading people? Logos, pathos, or ethos? Which is the most important? Ethos. By far and away the most important. Which is why when I had a professor one time, he said, listen, if you're ever on a pastor search committee, before you call the pastor, play softball with him. And on a close play at second base, when he was really safe, call him out. See what happens. Test the ethos. Why? Because credibility is what we're thinking we're about. I just want to sound smart and informed. Yes, all important. That's part of ethos. But if there is not compassion that is saying, I understand, I care, I'm bringing this to where it will help you in the situations you are facing, we are actually damaging the persuasion that we are trying to communicate to God's people that is so important. If you begin to say, therefore, you take somebody like John Broadus and he says, application is the main thing to be done. We are not ministers of information. We are ministers of transformation. And part of that transformation is saying, I'm willing to help you understand the personal consequence of this biblical truth, to come into your life, to show that I understand, I'm willing to help. Then it begins to help us think about, all right, how do I get this application to a message if it's so important? In traditional practice, if you were to take even homiletics training over the last 150 years in the United States, in the traditional teaching of homiletics, when did application occur? Beginning, middle, or end of a message? Traditional preaching prior to this generation, when did we teach that application was to occur? At the end, in the conclusion. So what we said was, and we didn't even know we were doing it, we were adopting what is known as the Puritan model. Okay, so it was the Puritan model of preaching. So in the standard Puritan model of preaching, the first hour and a half of the message was uses. I just did that backwards, I'm sorry. It was doctrines. What was the second hour and a half? I've already given you the answer. What was the second hour and a half of the message? The uses. Which is exactly the way it went. And some of you have read those Puritan sermons, you know. And for my 73rd use, you know. And we did kind of get beyond that. But we typically have adopted what is known as a deductive model of preaching. And the deductive model begins with doctrinal understanding, right? And so I may spend, you know, I don't know what your tradition holds, 20, 30, 35 minutes of developing the doctrine out of the text. And then in the conclusion, I will get to the particular applications. That upside down pyramid is what's known as the deductive model of preaching, right? So I develop the doctrines, I develop the exegesis, I say, here's all the truth. I move from universal truth to particular application. Now, there's different generations in the room, but let's just be honest with one another. If what I'm saying to most listeners in today's culture is, listen, you just hang with me for about 30 minutes, and after about 30 minutes, I'll tell you why this is significant. You tell me what's going to happen to most of your churches. How many people are still going to be tuned in? They're not tuned in. They don't want to tune in. In fact, they are very concerned about your ethos. Don't you care? Right? We make a mistake when we think that a sermon is a doctrinal essay. And yet it's very hard for us. Now, I taught homiletics for 30 years in seminary settings, so I'm speaking about myself, and I will just say, because of our academic setting for training pastors and training preaching and sometimes awarding students, we take away the notion that a sermon is a doctrine essay. It is not. Okay, what's the main thing to be done? Application. And it's not changing the tools that we have. It is changing what we think is being accomplished by and with our sermons. So if you say, if the traditional Puritan message, which those of you who know a little bit about the history of preaching, was unique in its time, that I would so do doctrines and then uses. Major portion of the message was doctrines. Lesser portion was the uses, okay? That actually has a name in the history of preaching, which was the lecta clerum, the lectures for the clergy. That's what that model was. The doctrine preaching going to the uses. That was known as the lectures for the clergy. The Puritan model was revolutionary because they took the lecta clerum and said, we're going to use this for the lecta populi. What has been serving pastors, the lectures for the clergy, we are now going to take into the church and use as sermons for the people. Those of you who know a little bit about American Puritan history, how long did that model work in American Puritanism? How long till the halfway covenant? Only a generation and a half. So we sometimes hold up as kind of the model, you know, the high point of North American preaching, where we had all this doctrine coming at people and a little bit of later uses, actually was not very convincing over time. And as some of you know, universalism and all the aspects of that began to unfold quickly in the Puritan tradition, despite the great models of preaching that we sometimes hold up so much. If you're not going to just do doctrines and then uses, you know, that you've got, 30 minutes of doctrines, and then, you know, in the last sentence, and by the way, go thou and do likewise. I mean, if it's not that, what are ways that I think we're trying to help each other preach more and more these days? One of the things that helps us is by, again, just kind of thinking of the standard model, even of preaching of previous generations. If you take the pieces, explanation, illustration, application, explanation, what does the text mean? Illustration, demonstrate what it means. Application, apply the significance of the text. We begin to recognize more and more, you pretty much have to do that in every main point. So that if you have a three-point message, which is common in the Western tradition for all kinds of reasons that you may or may not be aware of, but nonetheless, commonly, we recognize that application is being integrated throughout the message. That we don't speak for 30 minutes and say, by the way, there might be some significance to this. But every main point has its application. After 5 or 6 or 8 minutes, I say, what's the significance of that? And then I move to the next point that the text is and say, what's the significance of that? By the way, where will I typically even outline the problem that is being addressed by the message, the reason you should be listening? Where do you even begin to hear that? In the introduction. So even the introduction has, if you will, in it an ethos of application. That we're beginning to say, there's a reason you need to hear this. It's kind of beyond, and again, I don't know your circles well enough, Lutheran Brethren circles, but I will say in the vast spectrum of the evangelical church these days, denominational affiliation is breaking down hugely. I mean, we talk about being in a post-denominational culture. And the consequence of that is people do not just sit down and expect you're going to explain the doctrine of your church for the first 30 minutes. You know, that's just your job. People are sitting down to say, Pastor, have you got any help for me? Is there any reason I'm supposed to be here today? Have you got anything to say to me that's newer than 2,000 years old? Is there anything for me today? Oh, yeah, you need to know the history of our church. Well, actually, that's not why I'm here. I'm here because I want to know what the scriptures say about the struggles of my life. And if you can't address that, I won't be here very long. I mean, kind of the loyalties of denomination and ethnicity are breaking down hugely. Again, I don't know your circles well enough. If it hasn't already happened, it will. I mean, it's just kind of where we are. What we begin to recognize we are doing more and more as we say that we begin a message with identifying some reason to hear what's going on is we are saying, what was going on in that setting that required the writing of this text? In my circles, we call this the fallen condition focus. I look at the text and I say, all right, it's still my obligation to say, what is this text about? The first question, do you all study Haddon Robinson here, David? So the first question is still, what's the big idea? You know, as I look at this text, I'm saying, what's this text about? You know, all my exegesis, all my background, all my contextualization, all my historical study, I'm still saying, what's the big idea? What's going on here? What's this text about? We're not going to abandon that key thing. But a second key thing that needs to be done, if we're moving to the realities that we're all facing, is not only say, what's the big idea? What is going on here? But to ultimately say, what's the context, particularly, what's the concern? Why was this written? Not just what's here, why was it written? Now, if you're beginning to say, why was this written, that may not always be on the face of the text, right? The biblical writer may not say, this is why I'm writing this. So you still need your history. You still need your exegesis, you need your contextual studies to say not only what's here, but why was it written? What was the struggle? What was the issue? What was the sin? What was the rebellion? What was the faithlessness? What was going on then that required the writing of this text? Because what you and I are convinced of is that the scriptural passages are not random. That the Holy Spirit was not just saying, oh, here's something else you should know. The test is tomorrow, so... No, there's a reason that this is here. Romans 15:4, everything that was written in the past, which is a pretty broad statement, everything that was written in the past was written for whom? For us. Everything that was written in the past was written for us so that through endurance and the encouragement of the Scriptures, we might have hope. You know, sometimes things can have impressions that you don't even recognize the significance of until somewhere down the road. I remember reading a man several years ago who said he felt he had found the common denominator of all great preaching in all the ages, which is a pretty bold claim. The common denominator of all great preaching in all the ages. And the reason it's such a bold claim is, I mean, Chrysostom does not sound anything like Spurgeon, right? And Billy Graham does not sound like John MacArthur. And you kind of say, how could you say there are common denominators between a Puritan preacher and some, you know, millennial today who's in the Acts 29 network? You know, kind of say, common denominator? What are you talking about? Here's what he said. He said, the common denominator of all great preaching in all the ages is all great preaching gives people does not just give them information. It is not just inform. It is not only biblical. It takes the biblical information and it gives people hope. And that's not contrary to the Scriptures. Everything that was written in the past, says the Apostle Paul, was written for us so that through endurance and the encouragement of the Scriptures, we might have hope. That is its actual purpose. When you move to the we, this is for us, that we might have hope, you begin to say not only what's the big idea and what concerns cause it to be written, but finally, how are we like them? How are we like them? What is the fallen condition that the Holy Spirit was addressing for them, and how are we like them? Now, I don't have to guess that we are like them, right? There's no temptation taking you but such as is common to man. So if I'm saying there is some struggle there in the text, I recognize that people in my church are dealing with it because I'm dealing with it. I mean, there was a time in my life that I heard that verse, there's no temptation taken you but such as is common, that I thought that meant there's nothing that I struggle with that someone out there doesn't also struggle with. I do not believe that's what that verse means anymore. What that verse means is that there is nothing out there, the seeds of which are not also in here. there is no temptation taking you but such as is common to man. And I don't have to guess about that. Because James tells me, if I am guilty of one sin, how many am I actually guilty of? All of them. There's nothing out there, the seeds of which are not also in here. And if I look at the scriptures and I say, all right, now what's happening there? What's the big idea? What was the truth being communicated? But why was the Holy Spirit addressing it at that time? What was the context there? And by the way, how are we like them? After all, think of it this way. You read at Easter time the account of Thomas. Awful disciple, you know. Been in the school of Jesus for 3 years. Had the witness of the prophets. He's now got the testimony of the women, of Peter and John, and Thomas still doesn't believe. What an awful person. Aren't you glad you're not like Thomas? Is that why Thomas is in the Bible, so that you'll be glad you're not like Thomas? Why is Thomas in the Bible? Because we are exactly like Thomas. We have the witness of the women. We have the witness of the prophets. We have the witness of the apostles. We have the witness of seeing people changed in our own ministries and lives. And we run into difficulty and we say to ourselves, is this real? Is Jesus really the redeemed Savior, Lord, sovereign over all? Is this real at all? And we're just like Thomas. If we begin to look at the scriptures and say, not just what is here, but why is it here? And how are we like them? We are setting an agenda for the passage, which is more than an informational model. It is a transformational model. Because what I begin to recognize is what the scriptures are doing is they are taking truth to struggle. There is a truth that's being communicated in the scripture, and all my exegesis and my history and my context and my doctrine still have to be disclosed, explained, communicated, but I've got a purpose now. And the purpose is to deal with the fallen condition that the text itself is identifying that they have, because there's nothing taken them that isn't also common. Now, if I go back to my model and I say, what I'm really doing is, even from the beginning of the message, that I'm beginning to say, there is something that I need to be addressing that is applicational, it is the FCF. Even in the introduction to the message, I'm trying to say, what is the reason you should be listening to this? What is the struggle that we share with the people to the text? I mean, we aren't just to stand back and say, isn't Thomas awful? Right? What do we share with the people of the text? Now, again, lots of you are experienced preachers here, so let's deal with the realities here. Some of what we're doing is just good rhetorical practice. If you are not in a seminary setting, but you are in a Dale Carnegie course on how to win friends and influence people, right? Dale Carnegie would say that the way you should begin any message, if you expect to have listeners, is you put a man in a hole. If you put a man in a hole, what do people now want? They want to get him out of the hole. And particularly if they recognize they're in the hole too. They're invested in getting out of the hole. If from the very beginning of our message, true to the nature of the text, we say, here is the human struggle. Here is the human dilemma. Now, let me tell you how God is coming to the rescue. Let me tell you what this text says that will help you in that struggle. It's a different agenda for preaching. By the way, it's also a different agenda for application. The different agenda for preaching is, I'm now not just giving you information abstractly. Here's a doctrine you should know. You should know the tense of this Greek verb. You should know, you know, who the Amalekites were. You know, why? Why should I know that? You know. Well, if it has relevance to the struggle that you're in, is this truth being taken to struggle? That's That's not just information. That is information directed at transforming people's lives. Which means from the very beginning of the sermon, I'm not just informing people, I'm pastoring them. From the very beginning of the sermon. Even before I've stood up, I'm thinking, what would be the significance of this for my people? What struggles are they going through that this passage is addressing? It's not just changing the agenda of the message from information to transformation. It's changing the nature of application. Whenever I'm in preaching circles, seminary circles, and I begin to talk about application, people who have been abused by application automatically begin putting up the barriers, right? And here's the barrier, because we've all experienced it. I hear a message, and the preacher begins to apply, and I say to myself, that's not what that text says, you know. Or the way in which you present it is so legalistic. You seem to be saying that God will love people because they do what you say. Or because you're in a seminary that has rightly taught you it's important to do application, at the end of your message, or maybe even end of main points, you begin to create these lists of behaviors. Do this, and do this, and do this, and do this. You know, as a preacher, I hadn't even thought about these things prior to this sermon, but they told me in seminary I'm supposed to do application. So here's five things you're supposed to do. Now, if at the end of our message we are telling people, here's five things you're supposed to do, tell me what our people begin to feel at the end of every one of our messages. Yeah, oh no. Five more. They feel hopeless. Just you know, another list. Another bunch of behaviors. Here's just more. But what if the agenda is different? What if from the very beginning of the message, right there in the introduction, I have said, folks, here is a struggle that you have. And the gospel is dealing with that. Now, even I, my own heart begins to warm to this. I'm a pastor. I'm a shepherd. I'm a priest. I want to be saying to people, here's how God is helping you in your struggle. And now, if I'm really doing that, if I'm saying to people, here's the burden that you have. Your kids are going another direction. You wonder why you're dealing so much struggle with your spouse. You wonder what's going to happen to our nation. Whatever it is, here's the struggle. And now I'm saying, here's how God is dealing with that struggle. I'm taking truth to struggle. Now you tell me how people feel at the end of the message. They feel hope. Right? Instead of just burden, 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 more list, do's, do's, do's. Instead, I have been honest with the text. Here is the struggle of this text. And here is how God is teaching his people to deal with that struggle. Now I'm not heaping burden, I'm releasing burden. It's actually in Lutheran circles that we think about, not my terminology, the fallen condition focus. Classic Lutheran terminology is, what is the burden of the text? Which is different than what's the subject of the text. Okay? Subject of the text is taken to the burden of the text. But if you can get beneath the surface and say, what's the burden of this text? Why is the Holy Spirit writing this? And make that something that you state very early in the message, even in the intro, right? To say, here's a struggle you're dealing with. And praise God, this text is going to help you deal with that struggle. Now, the struggle may be rebellion. The struggle can be addiction. They can be awful things. It's not that we're just kind of, you know, becoming saccharine, sentimental, and nice. We're dealing with the hard truths of human struggle. But we are saying the message of this text is redemptive. And the reason it has to be redemptive is the very place that we started, right? That everything that is happening in the Scriptures, everything that was written in the past, was part of a redemptive message. And what we are dealing with, as we are dealing with the redemptive truth of the message, is we are saying there is a human dilemma. There's a fallen condition after the fall, right? There's a fallen condition, and God is redemptively dealing with that fallen condition. And that can just be kind of theological abstraction until we begin to say, how does that actually come to life in my message? It comes to life in my message by identifying the mutual condition that we share with those in the text And then the agenda of the sermon is taking the truth of the text to that. Now, here's what begins to happen when we do that. We invert the pyramid. A traditional deductive sermon says, I'm going to talk to you about doctrine for a while, and then I'm going to get to a particular application. If I actually begin to say, here's the human struggle, this text, I deal the struggle, here it is, I identify the struggle, and then I say, here's how the information of the text deals with that struggle, because that's what was going on in this text. Now I begin with the particular, and I build the doctrine to deal with that particular, which, by the way, is not an academic model, it is a conversation model. It's the way we talk to each other. Now, there are all kinds of reasons in our culture today that sermons are moving toward inductive models. And some of them, I will tell you, are philosophically, theologically wrong, right? So much of what is called inductive preaching is based upon the premise that there is no transcendent truth. And so all I can do is talk about you and your existential reality and your particulars. And so a lot of what has been sold as inductive preaching has been sold on a theologically eroded foundation. What I've tried to do just in this first talk is talk to you about, is there a theological foundation that you can embrace that says, if I will deal with human fallenness, I'm actually on the agenda of Scripture. And what that does is not really changing so much of the historical models that I've been following. I still will do explanation, right? I'm still going to say what this text says. I'm still going to demonstrate what that text was about with illustration. I'm still going to apply the text. But if before I get into all of that, I will say, what is the agenda of the text, right? What was the Holy Spirit addressing? That's actually taking the Scripture on its terms. It's actually looking at its context and purpose as part of the exegetical obligation of the preacher. If that begins to happen, maybe just as we're concluding this first section, some of the fun for us as preachers begins to have us examine our own models. If we are integrating now, and we're not just waiting for application somewhere toward the end of the message, if I'm thinking I'm integrating application into identify the struggle right in the introduction. And then as I'm wording my main points, each of them kind of keeps back coming to what is the struggle? What's the struggle? How does this information deal with that struggle? In that integrated model, I begin to recognize that each of these components, when the FCF is identified first, the explanation, the illustration, the application, each coming back to saying, how does God deal with that struggle? The message is transformative and redemptive, not just informational. Having said that, I want to think about those components, as you see it, the way I've written it with that little double helix there. Each of those components, explanation, illustration, application, are roughly of equal proportion, all right? Which for people trained in academic settings is very disturbing. Because what do we train in academic settings, what do we think ought to have the largest proportion? Explanation. That's why I paid the big bucks to go to seminary. Come on. we want all the history and the doctrine to, and I'm not saying that's wrong. But this generic model is problematic because there are no generic congregations. Right? We make choices. Now, it may help us to think about what are those choices and why are they being made. Now, again, some of you are young dealing with youth right now. Some of you are older and your youth minister's background is behind you. But just honestly, you are called to address the high schoolers in the parking lot before they get on the bus to go to the winter retreat. You're supposed to have some word from God for the high schoolers in the parking lot before they get on the bus to go to the winter retreat. Now, you're going to speak from the text, you know, but tell me what these bubbles are going to look like. You're dealing with the high schoolers in the parking lot before they get on the bus for their retreat. How big is the explanation component of your, how much Greek are you going to quote? How big's your explanation going to be? Not real big, probably, right? How much illustration? How much illustration? More. You're not being courageous. It's probably pretty big, right? How much application? Not much, but very pointed, right? So you would say, being true to the text, but also examining not only what the text says, not only what its concerns are, but who are your hearers, what's their background, what's the situation, what's the educational level. You know, you're thinking about lots of things to say what are the proper proportions of these different elements. Okay, deal with another congregation. You are, for whatever reason, you are called to address the local CEO forum of Focus on the Family. So these are affluent, managerial, powerful Christians, committed, right? They're part of the CEO forum of the local chapter of the CEO forum of Focus on the Family. So these are business leaders, highly educated, very powerful, highly affluent. And you're asked to give a talk, the CEO forum of Focus on the Family. Now, how big explanation?
Huge.
Yeah, pretty significant. Pretty significant. How much illustration? And I will tell you, this is a trick question. These are highly trained communicators. That's why they are where they are in their businesses. They give speeches all the time. They know the responsibility of communication. How much illustration for these people? It is significant, and it is very good, right? It says, I value communication. It is essential to my job. I know its importance. You as a preacher may have not think so, but I know I got to communicate with people, okay? CEO forum, how much application? Again, a trick question. How much application? Somebody's saying pretty little, and that's exactly right. Why pretty little for this group? They've already done it, or it is their job to do it, right? They've already done it. You know, you give me the information, it is my job to determine what to do. That's my job, that's my lifestyle, that's my career, that's who I am, that's what I do. You give me the relevant information, you make it sing in communication, and then you give it to me. It's my job to determine what to do about this. Very different. A lot of my preaching career was to miners and plant workers. So I've got mainly blue-collar people, not many college-educated, hardworking, generations of believers, by the way. What do those bubbles look like? How much explanation? Blue-collar, believers, line workers, how much explanation? Not a lot. How much illustration? A lot. How much application? A lot. That's why we ask you to come here, Pastor. You're supposed to tell us how to live. My job, my career, my livelihood is following instruction, right? So lay it out for me. I'm a committed believer. You tell me what to do, I'll do it. You identify, though. I mean, that's you're the man of the cloth. You've been to school. You tell me what to do. That's what I'm expecting of you. Now, everything I've just said in each of those is a caricature, a stereotype, unfair, bigoted, prejudicial, everything. Okay, we can put that there. All that I want you to hear is you make those choices. I mean, if you're a communicator, you don't just say this. I went to seminary, and I like preaching this way, and I learned there what a sermon is. It has this proportion of explanation, this proportion of illustration, this proportion. Because if you only preach, sorry, David, because I'm preaching against myself now. If you only preach the seminary model, what you will do is you will say, I need two-thirds explanation, one-third illustration, and one sentence of application. The entertainment model is the opposite. The entertainment model says, I need one sentence of explanation, I need two-thirds illustration, and I need one-third application. And we are not either. We are real ministers of the Word of God to real congregations that are as varied and different as the wonder and the goodness and the ingenuity of God can create. So we are obligated to say, I now have to apply this word to God's people. And in the application of God's word to God's people, I need to consider who's here, what's their background, what's the text about. But ultimately, I have to say, what's the fallen condition there? Why was this written? And with what I know about my people, say, how are they like the people of the text? One of the reasons we struggle with that, but I'm so pleased to talk to so many of you who are preachers, is we begin to recognize when we truly are preaching for transformation rather than information, that it becomes absolutely critical to think about not just what the text says. Now, here's honest talk, while those of you out of seminary, there was a time that you sweat bullets, right, thinking, what outline am I going to get for this text? You know, how am I going to outline this text? That was really, really tough. If you don't mind my saying so, that doesn't bother you much anymore. If you are experienced preachers, the outlines tend to jump off the page at you, right? You see the outline pretty fast. What do you struggle with? Application. That's what you struggle with. Because, to be fair, over the course of time, you begin to discover that the explanation is supplied to you. The explanation of the text, knowing the text, being able to use a commentary, go to the right website, you know, the explanation is supplied to you. Where does the application come from? Say it again. Experience. Experience with whom? Your congregation. Your people, your own hurts, your experience. So you begin to recognize, you know, all of us have this dream world. If they would just give me 40 hours a week to work on the sermon, I would come up with masterpieces, you know. Actually, you wouldn't, right? If you were not involved with the lives of your people, this would not touch the ground that they live on. And so you begin to recognize that the way in which we do application is by our experience with God's people. The explanation is given to us. The application comes from us. It's why it's actually much harder. So as we move into, where are we, Dave? We've got about 5 minutes left. As we move into another period, we begin to think, all right, how do I do this application that's actually ministering to people's struggle in such a way that I am reflecting my knowledge of who they are, so this is still anchored in the text, but dealing with the realities of God's people. So from the very beginning, I'm pastoring people, not just lecturing them. I'm pastoring them, not just lecturing them. And there's a transformative, redemptive purpose to the sermon. I'm going to stop and see if you've got questions in our last 6 or 7 minutes. So tell me, I've said some things with some intention of having you think in new models, but what questions have I raised in your minds? Yes, sir.
How many illustrations do you take for your own life?
That's a great question. Can you tell me, in your tradition, is it viewed as wrong to take illustrations from your own life?
As long as you ask.
So I'm from Reformed, and we don't mean by Reformed what you mean by Reformed. So let's say I'm from a Dutch Reformed tradition, at which it was anathema to use oneself in an illustration. My own sense is, if you do not do that today, people will think that you are uncaring, remote, and that. If there is not ever experience from your own heart in life of what you're talking about, you will seem out of touch with what people are experiencing. So I think there is some sort of pastoral prudence about the balance, right? If I only talk about, you know, my hobbies, my wife, my dog, my baby, you know, my military career, my sporting career, if it's all about me, then people, you know, they're put off by that, right? But if you never talk about you, you know, Frederick Buechner talks about, you know, the preacher should not be the only one in the church who does not recognize that the waves are 12 feet high. You know, we need to say, I understand, and be able to talk about our lives that way. My colleague, Zach Eswine, has a great phrase, I think. He talks about redemptive vulnerability is what our culture is waiting to hear from the preacher. Now, both words are important. Vulnerability says, there's no temptation taking you but such as is common to man. All we, like sheep, have gone astray. We have turned each to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. If even a prophet could say that, we ought to be able to say it. But redemptive vulnerability is not just vulnerability. Sometimes I hear young pastors today who know the importance of authenticity, of connecting with people, to say, I'm just such an awful person. You know, I just struggle so much. My wife and I had this awful fight before I came to church today. I don't even know why I should be up here talking to you, you know. Well, I appreciate the authentic vulnerability, but this is not helping me, right? Because now I wonder, what good is your gospel, right? So I need both sides of this. I need to know, I know what struggle is, and I know how the gospel helps. So I'm not perfect, but the Lord is helping me. Our family struggles too, but here how God is or has helped us over some humps. So if we're the family of perfection, you know, I remember being in a prayer meeting one time, hearing a woman in the little circle say, Lord, thank you for bringing Brian and Kathy into our lives. We know that they don't have any problems, but they, I go, oh no, you know, what am I communicating? So I think if we have that balance of, we need to be able to say to people, we know what life struggles are. But we also know how the gospel helps, those are necessary tandems. And then the things that Debo was mentioning to my right here, if you mention your spouse, you were experienced pastors, if you ever talk about your wife in the illustration, what does everyone in the church do right as you're talking about your wife? What does everyone in the church, you're all doing it. They look at your spouse, you know. So if you ever talk about your spouse or your kids, you have to, at the very same moment, not only have gotten permission, but within the illustration say, I got permission, right? You have to say you got the permission. Even if you have it, you have to say you got it. because otherwise people are thinking, what a jerk. You know, that you would embarrass your family, wife, whatever it is. And certainly if you're talking about people in the church, right? Not only that you got permission, you have to say that you got permission, or else people will not trust you. Right? But maybe more than you were asking. I think we are obligated in this generation to say we understand. I mean, it's just, there was a generation before where we were taught never to use personal illustrations. And I sometimes have to caution young people today, say, that does not mean now always use yourself in an illustration. That's overcompensation. Yes?
I got a wonderful illustration of credibility and compassion.
Yes?
In my early ministry, my wife would say fairly often, Paul says, speaking the truth in love.
Yes.
Why do you do such a good job in the first half and not the second half?
Yes.
Now do redemptive vulnerability. Were you helped by that? I think if you were able to hear, and help us here, that's part of the redemptive vulnerability. To understand, it's not enough just to say what's true.